Hello friends, welcome back to KNS Biochemistry. So in this video session, we are going to see about one of the area of proteomics, a very important and essential area, that is protein domains. So the structure of the domain, the functions of the domain, all are highly essential in proteomics. Let us start the session now. So in this session under proteomics, we are going to see about protein domains. It's a very important area of proteomics to study about the domains of the proteins. So that is what we are going to see in this session. So what is a protein domain? A protein domain is a conserved part of a given protein sequence. So you know that a protein is made up of amino acid sequences, and which is that a particular part, a conserved part of a the given entire amino acid sequences of a protein is called a protein domain. And tertiary structure of that protein that can evolve, that can function and exist independently of the rest of the protein chain, the rest of the amino acid sequences. So each domain forms a compact three-dimensional structure, that is 3D structure. A domain forms a 3D structure and often can be independently stable and folded. It is stable and folded very complexly. So many proteins consist of several structural domains. There are several structural domains present in proteins. One domain may appear in a variety of different proteins. Then molecular evolution, that is through evolution you are getting these changes, that is called molecular evolution, which uses domains as building blocks, and these may be recombined in different arrangements to create proteins. These proteins with different functions through molecular evolution. So generally speaking, domains, that protein domains vary in length from between about 50 amino acid residues to up to 250 amino acid residues in length. So 50 to 250, that is a variation in the amino acid residues. So very small or shortest domains, for example zinc fingers, are stabilized by metal ions or disulfide bridges. Domains often form functional units such as the calcium binding EF hand domain of calmodulin. Calmodulin is calcium carrying protein, a transport protein which carries calcium, calmodulin. Because they are independently stable, domains can be swapped by genetic engineering between one protein and another protein to make chimeric proteins, that is newly formed proteins. The concept of the domain, that protein domain, was first proposed by Wettlaufer in the year 1973 after X-ray crystallographic studies. Because if you want to study the structure of the protein or any structure, you have to use X-ray crystallography in those days. So after this X-ray crystallographic studies of HIN lysozyme, that is an enzyme, you see that the concept of domain was first proposed. That was studied in HIN lysozyme and papain. Papain is the protein of papaya. Then by limited proteolysis studies of immunoglobulins, the Wettlaufer defined domains as, what are these domains according to him? They are stable units of protein structure that could fold autonomously, that is independently. In the past, domains have been described as units, units of what? Units of all the three. One is units of compact structure, units of function and the evolution, that molecular evolution, and units of protein folding, that further folding. So here each definition is valid and will often overlap. For example, that is a compact structural domain. A compact structural domain that is found amongst diverse proteins is likely to fold autonomously, that is independently, within its structural environment. Nature often brings several domains together. That is, if you have more than one domains, they all the domains, you see that they are coming together to form multi-domain and multifunctional proteins with a vast number of possibilities, multi-domain possibilities. So in a multi-domain protein, each domain, that is, if you have more than two domains, it is multi-domain protein. Each domain may fulfill its own function independently or in a concreted manner with its neighbors. So domains can either serve as modules for building up large assemblies such as virus particles or muscle fibers, or they can provide specific catalytic or binding sites as found in enzymes or the regulatory proteins. So what is a protein domain then? A protein domain, a domain is considered the fundamental unit of protein structure, fundamental unit of folding, fundamental unit of function or molecular evolution and design. So the protein structure is compact one, it must be stable one, and that folding, that fold, protein folding happens autonomously or independently, and these domains, they have some specific functions. Yes. So if you have all these things, then it is called a protein domain. So a protein domain, it is a discrete portion of a protein assumed to fold independently, that is autonomously, and possessing its own specific function. Suppose if you take a mobile domain that is called module. So module is a mobile domain. It is a domain that can be found associated with the different domain combinations in different proteins. So that is called a module or a mobile domain. A domain is the fundamental unit functional unit, fundamental unit of protein structure and function. So it is fundamental unit of both protein structure and function. Then all the protein families, you see that if you take all proteins containing, definitely they will be having a specific domain with some protein structure or specific function. If you take any protein and the tertiary structure of the protein, so that is the further folded structure, primary, secondary, and the third one is the tertiary structure. So that structure of many proteins is built from several domains only. Very often each domain has a separate function. They have specific function to perform for the proteins. So if you have more than one domain, you see that each domain will have its own function, specific function. For example, some of the functions of the domains are, see that such as binding a small ligand, binding with a ligand. Example, a peptide in the molecule, you see that binding with a ligand. So that is one specific function. Then spanning the plasma membrane, that is a protein domain which is inserted inside the plasma membrane, that is called a transmembrane proteins. Then containing catalytic site, that is active site which is available in some enzymes. So the containing catalytic site is involved in very important function, that is enzyme activity. Then DNA binding region, that is called transcription factor binding area. Then providing a surface to bind specifically to another protein, that is protein-protein interaction. Then in some cases, each domain in a protein is encoded by a separate exon in the gene encoding that particular protein. So these are all the some of the possible functions, specific functions of the protein domains. So you can see the types of protein domains. There are several different types of protein domains available, and we can see them one by one. First one is head domain, second one is internal domain, third one is special internal domains, then tail domains. So we can see them elaborately one by one. First one is the head domain. So this head domain consists of the start codon followed by immediately by zero or more triplets in the codon, specifying an N-terminal tag such as protein export tag or lipoprotein binding tag. These head domains, they should begin with an ATG, that is the start codon is ATG, and include codons 2 and 3 of the protein at a minimum. For example, ATG is start codon. When ATG access start codon and the codons 2 and 3, 2 to 3, or ATG start codon and signal sequence is 2 and 3, and after that you will be having affinity tag, that is the domain tag of that particular protein sequence, amino acid sequences. Then next one is internal domains. These internal domains are protein domains, consist of a series of codon triplets coding for an amino acid sequence without a start codon or a stop codon. They have multiple internal domains that can be fused. For example, DNA binding domains, see that there are internal domains. Then dimerization domains, kinase domains, dimerization are there inside the cytoplasm of the cell. Then another type is called special internal domains. Internal domains followed by special internal domains. They are very short domains with specific functions, and they may be separately categorized, but they obey the same composition rules as normal internal domains. So examples for special internal domains: linkers, some of the cleavage sites are interins. Then the next one is a tail domain. The seed terminus of a coding region consists of zero or more triplet codons followed by a pair of stop codon, that is TAA. TAA is stop codon. In the simplest case, the stop codons terminate the protein translation with an end or a stop. So more complex tails may include degradation tags appropriate to the organism with different degradation rates. So here example, you can see a Tata box, TWATWA, it is called Tata box. So Tata box is a stop codon. A degradation tag followed by a Tata box acts as a stop codon, and an affinity tag followed by a Tata box is going to stop that protein translation. Then right side you can see that different protein domains, structure of different protein domains. First one C, that is class C, three major classes of protein domains. So this is mainly alpha domain, alpha type of protein domain, and this is a combination of alpha type and beta, that is alpha beta combined domain, and this one is mainly beta domain. So beta domain will be having the secondary structure of the protein, beta pleated sheet. Alpha domain will be having again another type of secondary structure of the protein called alpha helix and beta helix. So if you have combination of both beta and alpha, then it is alpha beta domain. Then here A is architecture, that is 32 architecture type domains are there, and this domain is called a barrel domain, which is having alpha and beta structures, and this is having three layer sandwich, which is having the sandwich of these two types. Then this is two layer sandwich. So from three layer sandwich you can get a topology, that is T structure, or you can have fold 820 fold groups, So that from this three layer you will be getting this domain, which is having C terminal end, N terminal end sequence, amino acid sequence. Similarly, in this domain also you have C terminal end, N terminal end. Here you have 70 other three layer fold families here. So from this topology you can get homology, that is H homologous super family domains, 1400 super family amino acid sequences. It forms this super family domain structure. So here you can see the T, the topology fold, 820 fold groups are there, and this is a protein which is having alpha, beta and a topology structure. Then it is having C terminal and N terminal ends. Then from there you can go to the homology structure, that is a super family of proteins. So these proteins are having further folding in the structure. And one example is lactate dehydrogenase. Lactate dehydrogenase, which is having one domain, 91 Dalton, one domain is there. Then this is another enzyme, phosphofructokinase. It is also having one domain, and it is the domain is the catalytic activity of that enzyme. So that domain is actually doing the catalytic, that is enzymatic activity. So you are having such kind of super families. Then from that you can get sequence family, that is 35% sequence family. From that you can get some 4000 families of proteins. All are having different varieties of domain structures. So that is why each enzyme or each protein is unique from other proteins, because of this specific structure of these domains. So if you take a primary structure of a protein, the primary structure is the string of amino acids, that is amino acid sequences of a protein. They ultimately encode its uniquely folded 3D structure, that is three-dimensional conformation. The most important factor here governing the folding of a protein into 3D structure is the distribution of polar and non-polar side chains of the amino acids. So folding is driven by the burial of hydrophobic side chains into the interior of the molecule, so to avoid contact with the aqueous environment. So generally proteins have a core of hydrophobic residues, that side chain of the amino acids, surrounded by a shell of hydrophilic residues. So since the peptide bonds themselves are polar in nature, so they are neutralized by hydrogen bonding with each other when the hydrophobic environment is maintained. So this gives rise to regions of the polypeptide that form regular three-dimensional structural patterns called the secondary structure of the protein. So primary structure is converted to secondary structure by this further folding. So there are two main types of secondary structures seen in the proteins. One is called alpha helix, the other one is beta sheets. Alpha helixes and beta sheets, these are all the secondary structures of the protein. Then some simple combinations of secondary structure elements that have been found to frequently occur in protein structures, and they are referred as super secondary structures. That is further folding in the secondary structure, alpha helix or beta sheets. That is called super secondary structure, or it is called motif. That is a specific structure of the protein called motifs. For example, the beta hairpin motif, it is a super secondary structure which consists of two adjacent anti-parallel beta strands joined by a small loop. So it is present in most anti-parallel beta structures, both as an isolated ribbon and as part of more complex beta sheets. So another common another example of a super secondary structure of a protein is the beta alpha beta motif. Beta at the both the ends, alpha at the center. So it is beta alpha beta motif, which is frequently used to connect two parallel beta strands. So the central one is alpha helix, which connects the C termini of the first strand to the end terminal of the second strand, that is beta and beta. So packing its side chains against the beta sheet and therefore shielding the hydrophobic residues of the beta strands from the outer surface. Then another type of association is called covalent association. So covalent bonding or association of two domains represents a functional and structural advantage, since there is an increase in stability of these domains when compared with the same structures non-covalently associated with. So other advantages are the production of intermediates within inter-domain enzymatic clefts, that is the active site of the enzyme is called inter-domain enzymatic clefts, that may otherwise be unstable in aqueous environments, and it can be fixed stoichiometric ratio of the enzymatic activity which is necessary for a sequential set of reactions. So here you see that arrangement, the three-dimensional arrangement inside that domain, especially that enzymatic clefts, that is going to act sequentially based on its stoichiometric arrangement. So the structural alignment is an important tool for determining the domain structures. So if you take a tertiary structure, in the tertiary structure you can get a lot of motifs, that is domain motifs. So several motifs pack together to form a compact structure, local or semi-independent units called domains. So the overall 3D structure of the polypeptide chain, that the tertiary structure of polypeptide chain, is referred to as the protein's tertiary structure. So these domains are the fundamental units of tertiary structure. Each domain which is having an individual hydrophobic core built from secondary structural units connected by some loop regions. So the packing of the polypeptide is usually much tighter in the interior than the exterior of the domain, so producing a solid-like core at the center, that is solid-like core, and a fluid-like surface. So at the center, solid-like core, and outer side, a fluid-like surface. So core residues are often conserved in a protein family, so whereas the residues in loops are less conserved unless they are involved in the protein's function. So protein tertiary structure can be divided into four main classes. That is, tertiary structure of the protein can be divided into four main classes based on the secondary structure, based on the that secondary structural content of the domain. So all alpha domains, the domains all are alpha, that is all alpha domains have a domain core built exclusively from alpha helixes. This class is dominated by small folds, many of which form a simple bundle with helixes running up and down. Then all beta domains have a core composed of anti-parallel beta sheets, usually two sheets packed against each other anti-parallelly. Various patterns can be identified in the arrangement of the strands, often giving rise to the identification of recurring motifs. For example, you have a Greek key and lock and key motif. So alpha plus beta domains, both combined, alpha plus beta domains, they are mixture of alpha, all alpha and all beta motifs. Classification of proteins into this class is difficult because of overlaps to the other three classes, and therefore is not used in the CATH domain databases. CATH is a domain, protein domain database. It's a biological database, CATH. So alpha or beta, alpha slash beta domains are made from a combination of beta, alpha, beta motifs that predominantly form a parallel beta sheet surrounded by amphipathic alpha helixes. So the secondary structures are arranged in layers or barrels. So all these domains, they have limits on their size. The size of the individual structural domains varies from, already I told you, from 36 residues, amino acid residues, that is seen in E-selectin, to 692 residues in lipoxygenase 1, another domain. Lipoxygenase 1 is having 692 residues. Selectin is having 36. So But the majority, that is 90%, that is majority of these domains have fewer than 200 residues, that is below 200 residues only, with an average of approximately 100 residues average. So very short domains, less than 40 residues, they are called short domains, like E-selectin 36 amino acid residues. So those having less than 40 residues are often stabilized by metal ions or disulfide bonds. So larger domains, they are having amino acid residues greater than 300 residues, are likely to consist of multiple hydrophobic core regions. Friends, we have seen about protein domain, the structure of the protein domain, then importance of the domains of the protein, and you see that this area of proteomics is highly significant one. Hope you have understood it well. So with this, I'm going to stop this session. I'll be coming back with you with another session. Until then, it's bye from KNS Biochemistry. Thank you very much. Namaskar.